So we have been seeing the description of seven immortal earths climbing one above the other in the transcendent. Guru, Surva, Swaha, Maha, Jana, Sabha, Satyam, seven earths. So Savitri is climbing through all those seven earths. And then she meets the Supreme Himself, who had taken until now the form of death for a purpose. So actually what we have is behind the void, behind death, behind void is the Supreme Himself who is standing. So Savitri said that after all, okay, this is also the creation of Supreme Himself. It is a creation for a certain purpose, a certain meaning, certain idea of force behind it, and therefore it is there. Now, she is there in the transcendent, and what does she see now? That person, all grace and glory and all divinity were here collected in a single form. All worshipped eyes looked through his from one face. He bore all goddess in grandiose glens. So the entire creation is, after all, is his manifestation. It is he who has projected himself in this entire creation. All grace and glory. That marvelous world is Savitri seeing, all the seven earths and beyond, all grace and glory and all divinity were here in that one single person, in a single form. All worshipped eyes looked through his from one face of his. He bore all goddess in his grandiose limbs. Everything is contained in his limbs. This is a very beautiful sentence, very lyrical, very poetic also. This is one of the rarest examples of extended alliteration running over the entire passage, all four lines. All grace, grace, glory, single Godhead, grandiose, G, is everywhere. Same with all L. See, L is present. All grace, all divinity, collected, single. All worship, again, he bore all goddess in a single name. So the L and G alliteration is very prominent here in all the four lines, you see. All grace and glory and all divinity were here. Here means, of course, that person. In a single form, all worshipped eyes. Now, this is a little puzzly thing. All worshipped eyes look through his. So, those eyes which have been worshipped are being worshipped. They are looking through his form on this. Worshipped eyes. The gods and goddesses whom we worship. They are the worship deities. They are the worship deities whom we adore, we worship them. What are they doing? All the gods and goddesses, they are looking through him. All worshiped eyes look through his. So they see everything from him. So you can say that actually, is definitely much, much, much greater than all the gods and goddesses. They are looking through him. From one face, he bore all goddesses. So that he makes clear again, all goddesses. All devatas and devis, gods and goddesses, they are looking through him. In his grandeur lens, everything is present here. So this is a kind of a Vishwarupa. Which you see here in this form. Vishwa, universal, world, complete. Rupa, form. Vishwarupa, that is the phrase which is described for the form which Krishna showed to Arjuna on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Mahabharata story is here. He shows the time spirit, Vishwarupa, darshan is here. He bore all bodies in his grandiose land. So you can see the singularity of this one person beyond everybody, every power, every light, every invasion. An oceanic spirit dwelt within. Oceanic. Vast. The same time full of contents. I think it is not ocean. Ocean can be always calm also. Oceanic has the kind of a dynamism in it. Oceanic spirit, very brilliant. By the way, these lines are meticulously beautiful. All grace and glory and all divinity. See, all grace. It is long, spotting. And glory and glow. Short long and read and short. Sorry, read short all. Short long. It is an abyss. And then divinity. Sorry, divinity. Divinity. Short long, short. Read. All grace and glory and all divinity were here collected in a single wand. Very beautiful material also. You keep on valuing that. And how sort of easily the whole poetry comes with alliterations, with materials, in all that. He bore all goddesses in grandiose land. An oceanic spirit dwelt within. That oceanic, vibrant, full of power, full of capacity, intolerant and invincible in joy. Nobody can comprehend joy. He won't tolerate any nonsense. Joy is a flood of freedom and transcendent bliss. Flood of freedom, what a phrase, you see. Flood of freedom and transcendent bliss. Head to immortal lines of beauty rose. So that is the beauty of his form, you see. In him. So now he has described he described the Supreme Purusha in the form of Savitri Singh. And he has now four aspects which are being described here, one after the other, in great detail. In him, the fourfold being bore its crown, that wear the mystery and nameless name. The universe writing its tremendous sense in the inexhaustible meaning of a word. The universe writing its tremendous sense that this creation has a meaning, has a content, and a purpose, has something to do. And that is what is written in that. In the inexhaustible meaning. So you cannot take away, exhaust the content, the possibilities, the meaning, the significances which are present in this creation. In a word, that is one single word, Brahma. The word stands for Brahma. In a word, meaning of a word. In him, the four beings, bore his crown, that wear the mystery of a nameless name. Mystery of a nameless name. If you had to give a In name, the name is second only name. Name is name. See, the rare mystery of a nameless name. In verse, it is indescribable. Yet you have to call something. It is ineffable. It is ineffable. But because it has taken a form, he is being, therefore a name. Therefore a name for that. Name is name. The universe having its tremendous strength. So we should not really dismiss the whole creation. Although there are difficulties, there are all kind of nonsensical things, etc., etc. Still, there is a tremendous strength behind all that. If only we know what that conveys, you see. If you only know what the meaning of the word is, in the inexhaustible meaning of the word, in him. So he has now introduced first the fourfold being, and now a fairly elaborate description of the fourfold being starts from here onward, you see. So before we go to that, see, fourfold being is not totally new to Indian spirituality. The first formulation of the fourfold being is in the Mandukya Upanishad. Mandukya Upanishad, what happened there? This is the rendering of Mandukya Upanishad by Sri Vindu. Om is this imperishable word. See, what we have in Savitri text also, word with word. Om is the universe. And this is the explanation of Om. So what we have here in Savitri now, the fourfold being this time here, is the exposition of Om. Basically, exposition of Om. And that is the word, you have already seen the word. The past, the present, and the future, all that was, all that is, all that will be in Om. Beyond time, in time, everything is in Om. The grandiose person, all Godheads are in his limbs, you see. So, likewise, all else that may exist beyond the bounds of time, not only past, present, future, but beyond the bounds of time, that too is Om. All this universe is eternal Brahman. This self is eternal, and the self is fourfold. Fourfold being now. He whose place is in the wakefulness, who is wise or the outward, who feels and enjoys gross objects, Vaishvanara, the universal male, he is the first. So, the first person, first aspect of this fourfold is, who is wakefulness, who looks outward, face and enjoys gross objects, everything, is Vaishvanara. Vaishva means Vishwa. The universal being. In fact, it's translated Vaishvanara, the universal being. He is the first. He whose place is so. Vaishvanara, wakefulness, the Sanskrit word for wakefulness is Jagrata, who is awake, Jagrata, wakefulness. Then second is, he whose place is the dream, Swapna, dream is Swapna, who is wise or the inward, that was outward, now inward, who feels and enjoys sexual objects, Tejasa, the inheritant in the mind, being the second. So first is Vaishvanara, second is Tejas. He whose place is the perfect slumber, who is in deep sleep, samaya profound. Correct? Profound samaya?
Profound?
Samaya profound.
Slumber, I don't know. What
does it
mean slumber?
Profound
sleep.
That's what it is. He whose place is a perfect slumber, who is become oneness, who is wisdom gathered into itself, he is made of mere delight, who enjoys delight unrelated, means kind of an absoluteness of delight. To whom conscious mind is a door, Pratnya, the Lord of wisdom, he is the third. So he is defined the third person now. So first is Jagrata, second is Swapna, third is Sushupti, slumber. Sleep. Jagrata, Swapna, Sushupti. Therefore, he who is, so this is the third one, now the fourth. He who is neither inward wise nor outward wise. Does not look inside, does not. Nor both inward and outward wise. Nor wisdom self gathered. Nor possessed of wisdom. Nor unpossessed of wisdom. So everything is there, you see. He who is unseen and incommunicable, unseizable, featureless, unthinkable and unnameable, whose essentiality is awareness of the self in its single existence, in whom all phenomena dissolve, who is calm, who is good, who is one, than whom there is no other, him did deem before. He is the self. He is the subject of knowledge. He is the object of knowledge. Such is the correspondence between the Upanishadic Prajnana, wisdom, and Sushupti, between Hiranyagarbha, Tejas, or Swapna. Well, let me elaborate this separately. Yeah, it is so highly profound, you see. Sushupti is the state. We come back to our starting text. So first, up to here, we have the introduction of the fourfold being. Now comes Virat.